explain himself and everything else.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I don't know. Okay. Okay, so thank you for coming. I know you're all tired because you have attended many lectures today. What I'm going to talk about is length scales. So these days we have an awful lot of instruments with which we can see at any resolution that we like. So for example, each dot over here is a single atom in a piece of iron. And then, you know, like in universities, we make the claim that by looking at atoms, we can construct huge objects like this. Okay? So this is the longest single unsupported span bridge in the world. It's between Japan and Pasir Island, and that distance there is 2 kilometers. It's made of steel. Now, what is the relationship? 2 kilometers, yeah. It's the longest single span bridge. I've been there. Actually, it's an earthquake zone as well. So, how do you relate observations that are made on an atomic scale to something that is so many orders of magnitude bigger than an atom? How can you possibly use a microscope and then claim you can design a bridge? That's the issue. Okay. I'm going to introduce a little bit of metallurgy first and then talk about the length scales. So the particular structure that I'm going to talk about is like this. It is a mixture of body-centered cubic iron.
Помнить о двух механизмах
face-centered cubic structure here to the body-centered cubic structure here. And by controlling those mechanisms, you can design an infinite variety of structures, which I will show you very few of those today. Now, the mechanisms are like this, okay? So supposing that you have austenite here, and it contains red atoms and white atoms. And this is the unit cell of the crystal structure. And you want to change that unit cell without any diffusion. Okay? Because you are conducting transformations at a low temperature, where atoms are not mobile. Then you can do that by physical deformation. So here we've changed the shape of the unit cell, but the chemical composition is exactly the same. Okay? And the neighbors of all these atoms are exactly the same. So this is what we call a diffusionless transformation, and such a transformation will cause a change in shape, external shape of the crystal. So there's a lot of strain energy because this will be pushing against many surrounding crystals. And therefore, it will form as a very thin plate because the thin plate minimizes strain energy. So this is an automatic mechanism of producing very, very fine grains, no deformation required. Or no rapid cooling. Now, the second method involves a lot of diffusion and only occurs at high temperatures. So here, for example, we take the parent structure, we break all the bonds, okay, and we rearrange the bonds so that we have a new pattern, a new crystal structure. Now, during the process of breaking the bonds and rearranging, you might also get a change in chemical composition. So most of the red atoms have moved into the ferrite in this case. So such a transformation does not produce a shape change. So it is not limited by strain, and the grains can grow very, very large. Okay. So if you want a very fine grain size, you should go for the diffusionless transformation and not for the transformation which involves a composition change. And just to summarize, we can change the crystal structure of austenite into that of ferrite by a deformation, or we can cut this part of this crystal and transport it to the other side to recover the shape, and that's the diffusion that you require to get a transformation which doesn't produce a shape change. So, whether or not a transformation is diffusionless doesn't depend on whether you've got alloying elements. In absolutely pure iron, you can get a diffusionless transformation. So this is a single crystal of pure iron, which was straight. It had then been heated extremely rapidly, and it underwent a diffusionless transformation, which resulted in this change of shape, which you see over here. So, in pure iron, you can distinguish between martensite, which is diffusionless, and ferrite, which involves long-range diffusion of atoms. So the mechanism of transmission is independent of whether or not you have alloy elements inside your steel. And I'm going to show you a movie now. And it's an extremely boring movie, okay? Because it involves this kind of a transformation which doesn't produce a shape change. We're taking a crystal of austenite, polishing it completely flat, and allowing it to transform into ferrite, which produces no change in shape. So, the temperature is dropping, and the austenite will begin to transform to ferrite at a temperature of about 760 degrees centigrade, and you will see nothing happening, because diffusion removes all the strain. It happens in a way that minimizes the change of shape, and therefore you see nothing. Okay, so you've gone below the transformation temperature, austenite has disappeared, and you've seen nothing. So sometimes it's very useful to watch boring movies. It shows that there is no change in shape. Now, in contrast, when we form those thin plates, just keep on watching this movie, and you'll see massive changes in shape on the surface of the sample book. This is like the formation of a range of mountains. You know, the deformation is very large, much larger than elastic strains. So that is what gives us a very fine grain structure. And in steel, we get a variety of transformations, and I'm focusing on this particular transformation. This is actually bainite producing a change in shape, whereas things like ferrite and perlite, they result in very boring movies. Now, of course, we can measure this accurately using an atomic force microscope. And here, the shear strain is of the order of 0.46. A typical elastic strain is 10 to the power of minus 3. So this is a very large amount of strain, which causes the transformation product to be extremely fine, without any deformation at all. So you can produce very fine grain structure, no deformation needed, no rapid cooling needed. Okay, so if I summarize about 40 years of work, this is the mechanism of the bainite transformation. You form a plate exactly like martensite without any diffusion. But carbon is a small atom, right? And it sits inside the holes in the crystal structure. And shortly after transformation, it can escape into the remaining austenite. And carbon stabilizes austenite, right? So if you allow this carbon to partition, you will end up with either austenite or carbides. Right? Now we can control the precipitation of carbide so that we end up with just a mixture of ferrite and austenite. Now, when this happens, it requires time for carbon to diffuse. So the region around the bainite plate is rich in carbon, but away from it, it's not. Okay. So what you produce is a distribution of carbon which is not homogeneous. So look, near these plates of bainite, we have the austenite retained because carbon has partitioned. But away from it, you've got martensite when you cool the material. And that is very bad for properties because this is untempered martensite. So, we do not have a uniform distribution of carbon, and the carbon that is partitioned stabilizes the austenite near the bainite plates, not far away from it. And therefore, the toughness of that microstructure is very poor. Look, you can see that the impact transition temperature, that means the transition from ductile to brittle, is well above room temperature. Right? You really want this to be at minus 100 degrees centigrade. Okay. So we have a non-uniform distribution of carbon, And we need to know this distribution. It's not uniformly distributed. What are the techniques that we can use? Can you tell me, how can we measure carbon concentration inside the steel, locally? Any ideas? Well, the atom images, and we can pull out the atom and measure how long it takes to fly between two points, and that tells us whether it's carbon, iron, or silicon. But there is a problem, okay? There is a problem, there's a big problem. I will illustrate that. We are measuring on a very small scale, and we want to make objects which are huge. So what is the relationship between a local measurement and a truck where, you know, a person is this size, all right? So we need to relate what we do at high resolutions to large length scales. And today you heard some lectures, if you were here earlier, which claimed materials which are stronger than steel. Okay. Whenever you hear that, don't believe it. Yeah? Because they do not think about scale. When you produce a material by severe plastic deformation, etc., you are not producing large objects. Right. And the same applies to carbon nanotubes, to graphene, etc. Whenever somebody makes a comparison against steel, it's usually not against the best steel, and they don't consider the scale of the object. Right, so transmission electron microscopy, you are all familiar with transmission electron microscopes. Now, we can use this in order to measure the carbon concentration. I'll show you how. In a typical transmission electron microscope, your sample will be about 100 nanometers thick. Right. Now, how much material do you think has ever been examined in the whole world using a transmission electron microscope? So I want the students to answer, okay? This is the first question. There is a reward if you answer. How much material, so let's say in kilograms, has ever been examined in all the transmission electron microscopes in all the world? Hmm? 100 grams. Any other offers? 1 kilogram, 100 grams. Okay, let us do a calculation. Right, this is, first of all, I'll show you how we measure carbon concentration using a transmission microscope. This is a high resolution image of the ferrite, and you see these lines over here. Those are planes of atoms, right? And in this case, there are 0, 1, 1 planes. And the presence of carbon will expand the distance between those planes. So by measuring the interplanar spacing, we can work out the local carbon concentration. And you can do exactly the same in the case of austenite. It's difficult to see. Can you see these lines here? Yeah, those are the 1, 1, 1 planes of austenite. Now the reason why it's difficult to see is because in a high resolution microscope, dislocations and other defects also give rise to local strain fields. Right, so you have to be careful when using a TEM in interpreting these images. Okay, so let's do a little calculation, all right? So we have a foil which is 100 nanometers thick, and it's 10 micrometers by 10 micrometers square, typically, the thin area. So the volume of that foil is 10 to the minus 17 meters cubed, and just for round numbers, we'll assume that this is the density of the material. It's about 7,800, but I'll take it as 10,000. And let's say we take 1 million images every year, and that the transmission electron microscope has existed for 100 years. That's an exaggeration, but it's a nice number. So the total amount of material that has ever been examined in a transmission electron microscope is 10 to the minus 5 kilogram, and the weight of this is 10 to the minus 2 kilogram. So how can you claim that when you make an observation in a TEM, you can go and build a bridge? Okay. So who said 100 grams? Okay, so you are the nearest. So So this is just published, okay? I mean, you were out. You were out by a factor of quite big, okay, but you were nearest, all right? So remember, you know, when you use high-resolution equipment, you are actually looking at an incredibly small amount of material, okay? Right, now the atom probe. The atom probe works as follows. You've got a specimen which is shaped like a very small needle, and you apply an electrical potential, and you have some imaging gas in there which will follow lines of the electrical field and give you a magnification of 10 million times. And you can also apply a pulse, electrical pulse, which will make an atom evaporate and then fly in this time of flight mass spectrometer. So you can identify the chemical composition of an individual atom. Right. Now, we said that the total amount of material ever examined in TEM is 10 to the minus 5 kilograms. Right? In this instrument, it is orders of magnitude smaller than that. Right? So we can measure carbon concentration using an atom probe, I'll show you. So this is a mixture of austenite on this side and bainitic ferrite on this side. Here we are forming an image with just the iron atoms, and here we are forming an image with just the silicon atoms. And carbon, and you can see that the carbon is on the austenite side of this image. So each dot is a single atom. Okay. So you can analyze atom by atom. And when I did this experiment, we collected 2 million atoms. Now that sounds like a lot, but in 50 grams of iron, there are 10 to the power of 23 atoms. Okay, so it is negligible. It's less than a piece of dust, the amount of material we are looking at. And a modern atom probe can measure more atoms, but they're still very, very small. And this is from Francisca's work, where you can see the distribution of carbon atoms in the ferrite, and in the austenite is much richer. And also you can see carbon atoms at dislocations, because they're attracted to dislocations. And you can make measurements at different locations in the austenite, and you find that the concentration on that scale is not constant, okay? So, once again, we do not have a uniform distribution of solute in our material. So now I'll show you a comparison between measurements made using the transmission electron microscope, which looks at more material than an atom probe, right? Orders of magnitude more material, even though the total amount ever examined is 10 to the minus 5 kilograms. So these are experiments I did in 1981, where these are measurements from transmission microscopy. And the reason why we have error bars is because local strain fields put uncertainty in the measurement of distance between planes of atoms. Right? The images that you saw, the fine lines going, those are planes of atoms. And these are measurements made using the atom probe. And obviously we are sampling a lot less material using the atom probe. So we are not picking up things like these. And what are those? Well, we often talk about this material as being free from carbides, but actually there are very, very small, incredibly small carbide particles inside the material, which we didn't pick up with the old atom probe, but we can find with the new machines, which collect many more atoms. Okay. So, depending on the technique you are using, you are going to sample a different amount of material. And you could argue that if you want to measure the composition of an interface, which is a two-dimensional defect, then these techniques are perfect, because there is no other technique by which you can measure the composition of an interface. But even there, you have a problem, because look over here, look at the width of this interface. It's of the order of 10 nanometers, right? That's too big. You know, when we look at an interface in a transmission electron microscope, it's not 10 nanometers, it's of the order of 1 nanometer wide. So what's happening is that when we pull the atoms using electrical pulses, they're not perfectly maintaining the location of the interface. The interface could be curved, and it may not be vertical. So I don't see any segregation at the interface. But is that because I'm measuring a large width instead of a very fine interface area? I don't know. Okay, this problem is not solved. Right, so we want to look at a larger amount of material, and I think Wolfgang here indicated that we have techniques in which we can examine, say, 10 millimeter thick sample, right? And synchrotron X-rays are very powerful, and we can penetrate 10 millimeters of steel. So a synchrotron basically is electrons which are accelerated around the ring. And when you accelerate electrons, you get X-rays, very high energy X-rays. Okay, so these are effectively beam lines where you're pulling off X-rays to do your experimental work. And the advantage of this is you can rapidly get diffraction information. What that means is that you can actually transform the material and take a diffraction pattern every second, right? Whereas the equipment which we would normally have in a laboratory, you know, you might have to expose for several hours to get a proper diffraction pattern. So here is an example of synchrotron data of the same material that I was talking about, the atom probe and the transmission microscope. Here we are basically holding the material at a constant temperature, but time is increasing this way. And this this is a peak from platinum, which we put deliberately to make sure that, you know, we are not spreading out the peak for reasons of instrumental problems. Okay, you can see it's a very, very fine peak. So any broadening that you see here is real. Okay, now this is the peak when ferrite starts to form, and this is the austenite begins to decompose. Now notice, it's a bimodal peak. Can you see? You have here austenite with a low carbon concentration, and here you have austenite with a high carbon concentration, which is surrounding the bainite. And this peak is sharper than this peak because it's unaffected by the transformation. Okay. So here we can demonstrate directly the inhomogeneous distribution of carbon while the transformation is happening. Okay. Now there are other reasons for using synchrotron, but today I'm just talking about sampling volumes. Here the sampling volume is much, much bigger than the transmission microscope or the atom probe. Okay, going back to this diagram where I said the mechanism by which this forms is completely diffusionless, and then the carbon partitions into the austenite, and the time scale for this carbon partitioning is of the order of seconds. Right, so the carbon can escape from the ferrite in a matter of a second or two. What I want to know is at what point does the formation of the ferrite stop? At what carbon concentration, average carbon concentration, does the formation of ferrite stop? Because that gives me information on whether my theory is correct, that bainite is a diffusionless transmission. So here is a plot of Mary Sandy. She's gone somewhere, but she is the expert on thermodynamics. Here we have free energy of ferrite and free energy of austenite. If I draw a common tangent here to make a phase diagram, then I get the classical AE1 and AE3 phase boundaries. This is ferrite plus austenite and austenite. But there is another point, which is this, where austenite and ferrite of identical composition have identical free energy. What that means is that if I transform austenite into ferrite of the same composition, that means without diffusion, then I have a reduction in free energy here, but an increase in free energy here. So this is the limit of the composition of the austenite which can transform without diffusion. Right? And on the phase diagram, it will be called the T0 curve. On this side, it's possible to transform austenite without diffusion. On this side, it isn't. So I want to measure the composition of the austenite at the point where the reaction stops. And schematically, it's like this. I allow bainite to form, and I measure the point at which it stops. If it stops at T0, then my theory is correct. If it stops at the equilibrium boundary, then you cannot have diffusionless transformation. Okay. So I want a macroscopic measurement. And you can use dilatometry to measure the carbon concentration, because the lattice parameters of austenite and ferrite change with the carbon concentration, and therefore the transformation strain between austenite and ferrite will also change. The dilatometer is basically a small specimen that, well, small, I would say 5 millimeters diameter, 10 millimeters long, which you put, this is an induction furnace, and you have some transducers which measure the dimensions. So you can follow the transformation while it happens, and you can measure the transformation strain, and from that calculate the carbon concentration. And when you do that, you find that it agrees with the mechanism that I was suggesting, which is diffusionless transformation with carbon partitioning afterward. This is a macroscopic measurement, right? So it doesn't take account of the inhomogeneous distribution of carbon. It's saying, on average, the reaction will stop when the carbon concentration anywhere in the material reaches the T0 composition. And that is the reason why, the T0 curve is the reason why this has very poor toughness, because the reaction stops when these regions reach a composition which is T0. After that, it's not possible. Okay? Thermodynamics tells you that it's not possible. So, Sandy, I introduced your work here, but you were not here. Okay? So, talked about thermodynamics and phase diagrams. Okay? So, the toughness is extremely bad. Yeah? And that is the result from thermodynamics. Nothing else. Because you have these large regions which will decompose into untempered martensite. So, what can you do about it? Well, if we can increase the amount of bainite, then these regions will be consumed. Okay, so they become smaller and smaller. And if you have brittle material and you make it small, then it no longer behaves in a brittle way. Okay, for many reasons. So, a simple equation for the volume fraction of bainite, I want to make the volume fraction large. Okay? And the volume fraction is simply this distance divided by this, where this is the composition of the ferrite, the composition of the austenite, where the reaction stops, okay, the composition of the ferrite and of the austenite. This is the average carbon in your steel. Okay? So, how can I maximize the volume fraction of bainite? Can somebody answer? What can I do to increase the volume fraction of bainite? No. Students have to answer. Okay, there's a simple equation. Yeah. Can you tell me? Just look at that equation. What will increase V? What will increase this? What can I change here to increase? Go on. Do what to X alpha? Okay. Now, X alpha is very, very small because the solubility of carbon in ferrite is very small. What else can I do? Yeah, increase X to zero, because you can do that by changing the other elements. And one more. We've looked at this, what do I need to do to X bar, which is the average carbon concentration?
Reduce it,
yeah? Okay. Where is my bag? So you can share this book, okay? Thank you. Right, so with this simple equation, we can modify the carbon concentration, and immediately, without doing any other experimental work, we shift the impact transition temperature by 200 degrees centigrade, and you have a tough steel as well as a strong steel. Okay, so there isn't much experimental work with it. We simply modified the volume fraction of bainite by altering the terms in that equation, and immediately we change the impact transition temperature from 100 degrees centigrade to minus 100 degrees centigrade. That is an astonishing change in the ductile brittle transition temperature. And of course, It's an old story. This is a rail made from that material on this side, and this is ordinary pearlitic rail, which is head hardened. That means good quality pearlitic rail, and it has had 90 million tons of traffic on it, and you can see the difference here. Okay. So this is also in the Channel Tunnel between the UK and France. I don't know what happens when we leave the European Union, but right now it's there. Okay. You can see it over here. Look, this is the Channel Tunnel, and these are the carbide-free magnetic rails, which are very, very good rolling contact fatigue resistance and wear resistance. Okay, so going back to this diagram, this is the structure, and the scale here is 1 micrometer. So these plates are about a quarter of a micrometer in thickness, and it's the thickness which controls the grain size of a plate, right? Because that's the mean free slip distance. Now, this is not a nanostructure, right? Because it's a quarter micrometer. In my book, a nanostructure is the size of a carbon nanotube, the width of a carbon nanotube. Now, if I alter the transformation temperature without any deformation at all, I can immediately get the world's first bulk nanostructured material. So this you can make in thousands and thousands of tons. You can see the size of these plates is at the same magnification as a carbon nanotube. And this is the world's first bulk nanostructured material. Doesn't require any deformation, doesn't require any heat treatment, rapid cooling. No, the deformation happens by transformation. Now, the amount of interfacial area here is 100 million square meters per cubic meter, which is greater than any severe plastic deformation. Right? 100 million square meters of interface between two different phases in one cubic material of material. Now, there's a problem. When we calculate an interfacial area, we are assuming that it's a flat interface. But supposing it is rough. Now, what do I mean by rough? Well, a sphere is completely smooth, but a strawberry is not. The surface of a strawberry is not smooth. If I look at higher and higher resolution, I will get a bigger and bigger surface area for the strawberry. But for the sphere, it will be exactly the same no matter what resolution I look at. So we have to deal with this problem, because in some cases, we want the interfacial area at a high resolution. So for example, if hydrogen atoms are going to the interfaces, then I need to know it at the resolution of a hydrogen atom. In other cases, we're talking about toughness, it's the plastic zone of the crack tip. That's the scale on which I want to know the interfacial area per unit volume. So Mandelbrot, many, many years ago, created, I think it was Nobel Prize winning, right? Mandelbrot, isn't he? Okay, well, he won a very important prize.
He's only a big
name. Yeah. So he created a theory called fractals, right? And fractals means that you look at the whatever object you are classifying at different resolutions, and it follows a systematic law, which then allows you to predict the area as a function of resolution. So, just to show you that this is not a perfect fractal, but an approximate fractal. This is what the plate of bainite would look like on an optical microscope. Right? This is an optical microscope. If I do it in a transmission electron microscope, that single plate of bainite actually consists of thousands of small plates, very, very small plates. Right? And then if I look at one of these plates at an even higher resolution, there are tinier plates there. Okay. So what I do is I measure the area as a function of resolution. Okay. So imagine that this is the map of a country, and I want to measure the perimeter. So I put calipers like this, and I follow, and I have a perimeter. If I space the calipers very finely, I will get a different answer, because a large spacing caliper cannot measure this, right? But a small spacing. So if a child is walking around, it will measure a bigger perimeter than if an adult is walking around. Okay. So then when I plot the logarithm of the perimeter, which is the logarithm of the resolution, I get a straight line. And there is this term here, which is known as the fractal dimension. Once you've determined that term, you can calculate the perimeter as a function of any resolution. Okay? That is basically Mandelbrot. So in the case of the bainite that I was saying, we did this work. And the surface area per unit volume is related to a constant here, and this is the fractal dimension of that object. So we measured that fractal dimension. If you're thinking about a plastic zone, then what we would substitute for resolution is 10 micrometers. Right. But if you want to talk about hydrogen at interfaces, then we need to measure the surface area with a different resolution. Okay. So we have these values, and if I plot them, so the fractal dimension of that object is actually 3.59. If it was smooth, it would be 4. Okay. And this is how the surface area per unit volume varies with the resolution. If it was 4, it would be a much greater variation. Okay. So again, you see, when you think about measuring surface areas and so on, they're okay for smooth geometrical objects. But if they're rough objects, we need to use a different kind of theory to determine the fractal dimension. Right, we heard about mechanical alloying in one of the other lectures, the ball milling, where you take different metal powders and you mix them up. And then you deform them together until they form a solid solution. And you know, this was a commercial process and is again coming up as a commercial process, where you can make large quantities and then consolidate by extrusion and create some really interesting structures. So here the grains are going around the tube. Okay. You can see these grains, they are growing circumferentially, and that is what was needed because the hoop stress is largest along that direction. Now, if you do an atom probe experiment to discover whether you have created a solid solution, okay, you can analyze atom by atom by atom. Using the time applied mass spectrometry. And this is the kind of plot that I get for chromium set in the material. We're looking at the composition of 50 ion clusters. There is absolutely no error here, okay? Because you know, each atom is analyzed one at a time. So my question is, and I don't have any more books to give away, but my question is this a homogeneous solution? That it is not.
We don't know what we start to do it from this.
You are right. We cannot tell just by looking at this that this is homogeneous or not, because the meaning of homogeneous is different when you're looking at the atomic structure. So what it means is that if the distribution of compositions follows a binomial distribution, then it's homogeneous. But if it doesn't, then there is some chemical segregation. So I'll show you. Here we have the experimentally measured distribution in black, and this is the binomial distribution. And when you compare these two, if they match, then your solution is homogeneous, and the mechanical alloying process actually produced a homogeneous solution. There's no melting involved, it's just hitting things together. So my message basically is that in particular when looking at iron, because with iron we make objects which can vary from a small size to incredibly large size, we need to think about the data which come from high resolution experiments, and we need to look at many different magnifications to get the real picture. Okay. And I will stop there and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Questions? So you showed you produced bulk nanostructural steel, but it was very elongated.
No. So again, you see, we have to look at different scales. No, it's not elongated. Let me just show you. So it's a very good point, because I should have shown a picture at the optical scale. So this is that picture, same picture. Okay. If I show you the optical micrograph, it's isotropic. So these things are pointing in all directions. But we were looking at a very, very small area, and that's why they looked like they were elongated. This is an isotropic material.
Okay. I get to finish what means about construction because SPD. So only one direction is now. One direction.
So that's a common mistake, because the mean free slip distance of a plate is twice the thickness. So that's how we define grain size. By mean free slip distance, linear intercept is basically like that. Yeah, so this is very, very strong.
You mean strong definition?
So I don't like to talk about strength alone. Because for anything that we make, it isn't just strength that's important. You have to have many other properties optimized.
Okay.
Yeah.
So this is really not anisotropic. Yes.
It's not anisotropic. So I mean,
this is important.
Yeah. So let me just show you what I mean by bulk. This is the size. Yeah. So a man is about this high from here to here.
Questions?
Yeah.
When you studied carbon movement in the sea, is there another elements go to move?
Other elements,
yes.
Yeah. So we showed using the atom probe,
yes,
that the substitutional solutes do not move. Mm-hmm. And that is consistent with the shape deformation that you observe. The carbon is not is inside the holes in the lattice, so it can move, but the other atoms are frozen at the temperature at which this happens.
For example, maybe sulfur.
Sulfur we haven't looked at.
Would be like carbon. This light material.
It may be, but we haven't looked at that. We only looked at the substitutional alloying elements like chromium, molybdenum, nickel.
Yes.
Because it's being recorded, so we need the microphone.
Sir Kadesh, do you use Mesbauer spectroscopy for the estimation of carbon distribution, the uniformity of carbon distribution? Because this is not my term. This is it's possible to use more quantity of material for this estimation.
Yes.
And the result will be better than from the TEM or mass spectrometry.
You are right. So I'm not an expert, but my colleague Daniel Crespo in Spain, he did the experiments using Mosbauer on the same material to look at the distribution of carbon.
And?
Yeah.
What he found? Because Mosbauer spectroscopy from the spectrum which we receive, possible to separate austenite and ferrite.
Yes.
Directly, because the lattice varies. And this is from one point of view. This is the local atomic probe method. And from another point of view, this is massive. It was possible to estimate a lot of quantity of material. And looking on the shape of the line, Mesbauer's spectrum, it was possible to estimate how
the neighbor,
how, yeah, the,
yeah,
neighbor, the neighbor,
yeah,
what is the
environment.
Variety of environment and the validity of distribution, the change of carbon concentration around the iron atoms.
That's right. So, to be honest, we didn't look in detail except to measure the carbon concentration in a local region, but we haven't looked at the environment. And I can send you the paper. Yeah, for your comment.
Oh, okay.
It's a long time ago.
Oh, thank you very much.
And we're making shaft for an aircraft engine. So these are the blanks. Okay.
So already industrial installation.
Yeah. Now we may not use this material because we are trying two different concepts. But yeah, we may not use it. So the thermal stability is important here. The shaft reaches a temperature of about 300 degrees centigrade.
So it's not
there. But it has to survive for 40,000 hours. Yeah. So
okay, but let's say 40,000 hours is on the in air or the railways.
Right.
Not 300 degrees centigrade.
Yeah.
Up to now, it's warming is going on, but I hope it will be not.
Yeah.
Degrees.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sure.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I think there was another question there as well. Yeah.
This nanotube, carbon nanotube, tube inside steel.
No.
In original form or?
No, there is no carbon nanotube inside. I was just comparing the size.
Yeah.
There's no carbon.
But we don't use it.
No. It's not possible because carbon dissolves in iron. So even if you introduce it, it will simply dissolve like coal.
Oh, of course. Yeah. Maybe it plays the role of center of alternates in grain formation. It possible the nanotube transform to the chamber of carbon iron, carbon atoms, and form the oriented center mesh.
I think somebody over there wanted to ask a question. No? Okay. So, before we stop, let me take a photograph, okay?
Can I ask a question?
Yeah. Oh, sure. Of course you can.
Am I right that always we have not uniform distribution of carbon in steel on micro levels?
Yes, I think that is absolutely right.
Always.
I have never seen a high resolution experiment which shows a uniform carbon. Because we have defects, we have boundaries, you know, even the structure is not uniform everywhere. And carbon gets attracted to many things. Yeah.
I joined a question which and we found that manganese is distributed not uniform.
Right.
And we see that if we have less manganese, these places first change to from austenite to ferrite.
Yeah.
It's very clear, and we couldn't understand exactly why and what was the size of the zones, but it seems that usually elements distributed not uniform.
So, you know, the problem is during solidification, you get segregation, and that is spread out by the deformation into bands. And you form the ferrite in the manganese depleted regions, and that pushes carbon in the other region, so you get perlite over there. So that's the classic bending that you see in steel.
Thank you. I also want to ask about non-uniform. Distribution. Does it mean that if I want to predict the carbon particles formation, I must predict the difference? No, and in fact, no other way for this prediction?
It depends on what you want to predict. So, if you want to predict the distribution of carbides and the size of carbides, probably.
And
probably. Depending on the size of the carbides as well, probably you need to think about whether there's a heterogeneous distribution of carbon. But if you just want an overall number,
for example, number of particles in cubic meter.
Mm. I think you can work on averages. You can work on averages to get an idea.
Well,
no questions.
Okay, wait.
Let's thank speaker.